Welcome back once again. You're still tuned to the Saudi Morning Show. That was a look at the stock market, and we hope that it was a beautiful look for most of the people, especially the ones who have a lot, a lot at stake at the stock markets. But well, we are going to be moving on in today's edition of the program, welcoming our guest to the studio, who is joining us today to talk about a very, very important subject, and again, a medical condition that we really need to be spreading more awareness about. We're going to be talking about antiphospholipid syndrome with Dr. Mohammed Asif, who's a consultant thrombosis and internal medicine expert. Assalamu alaikum and good morning, Dr. Mohammed. How are you doing?
Good morning for you and your viewers.
Thank you very much, Dr. Mohammed, for joining us in today's edition of the program, and especially talking to us about a disease which is really, really, or rather a syndrome, which is very anonymous to a lot of us, even as it goes by the name. So first of all, Dr. Mohammed, just introduce it to our viewers a little bit, and also autoimmune diseases in general.
Yes, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Antiphospholipid syndrome, it is autoimmune condition or autoimmune disorder, meaning that our immune system usually develop antibodies against foreign bodies like bacteria, viruses, okay, defense system. But what happens sometimes have autoimmune disease, that immune system will develop mistakenly antibodies against our cells and tissues, causing damage. Just we'll say the immune system similar to the military, you know, system, okay, that should fight, okay, for the country. Sometimes what happens, they will fight.
Instead of protecting, it will be attacking.
Attacking. This is what will happen. So the immune system mistakenly attack body cells and tissues. So this is autoimmune disorder. I think this is introduction to our disease, which is antiphospholipid syndrome. First, let's go with syndrome. Syndrome is different from a disease because syndrome, it is a group of symptoms without clearly defined reason. But a disease usually, it is a group of symptoms with a clearly defined reason or etiology. That's why it is a relatively a new disease for the last 30 years. It was discovered by a scientist, a physician, Hughes. That's why other name of the disease, Hughes syndromes. So antiphospholipid is autoimmune disease. What will happen? So we will, our autoimmune system will produce antibodies. Usually antibodies are proteins, okay, that part of the immune system. These antibodies will attack our cells, particularly our blood cells and our endothelial cells. Endothelial cells are the cells lining the blood vessels. We call it endothelium, the innermost of blood vessels, arteries, and veins. That's why we'll increase the risk of blood clot formation anywhere, okay, and pregnancy complications like miscarriages or stillbirth. This is just in, I mean, simplified, okay.
This fashion. Is the process inside the body, but talking about outside, if there's, is there any early like early signs for such a problem that a person could witness and then seek a physician?
Yes, that's why, I mean, this is leading us to what are the clinical manifestations, the symptoms and sign of the disease. Sometimes the first presentation, the first clinical presentation of the disease is blood clot. So the patient will present with blood clot in the leg veins. We call it deep vein thrombosis or DVT. This is could be the initial presentation with a leg swelling, redness, hotness, and pain with difficulty walking. We diagnose them as a DVT. Then usually deep vein thrombosis, what's the underlying cause for it? Could be antiphospholipid antibody syndrome or antiphospholipid syndrome. So this is one of the manifestation, blood clot, not only limited to the veins, it could be the veins or it could be the arteries, stroke. If you have a stroke, usually stroke developed in elderly male, typical with typical vascular risk factors, smoking, diabetes, hypertension, and strong family history and high cholesterol. But these patients, sometimes you see a young chap presenting with a stroke, then it will trigger you, he has no classical risk factor for stroke. So what else? It could be this disease, the antiphospholipid syndrome, which is the autoimmune syndrome. So it can present in a variety of ways, or could be a pregnant lady have recurrent or frequent miscarriages without explained, without clear cause or identifiable cause. The fetus will be morphologically normal. I mean, there is no chromosomal abnormality. There is no structural abnormality in the uterus. No abnormality, then it is occurring frequently. Then we'll start to say, oh, could be this is the reason, antiphospholipid syndrome. So it can pregnancy, very important, pregnancy complications, which is one of the common cause here in our country, Saudi Arabia, to have recurrent or frequent pregnancy complications.
Indeed, but also tell us a little bit about these problems with the antiphospholipids, Dr. Mohammed. For instance, is it easy to be diagnosed as well? Because a lot of the times people may not really go to the expert in a particular area, so they may go just to a family medicine practitioner and he's going to do some of the basic tests. Are some basic tests able to overrule this?
Excellent. Okay, we usually antiphospholipid syndrome treated in tertiary care hospitals. Okay, and usually the primary health care physician.
So should we understand that it is a health condition, not really much different than cancer or some of the other severe problems?
Yes. So I mean that the primary health care physician suspect the disease, okay, and refer to us for confirmation. The blood test we do it usually not available in primary health care center. Usually in secondary or tertiary care center. It is a disease different than cancer. It is not a cancer. It is not infection. It is not inflammation. It is just autoimmune. A disease can occur either alone by itself. We call it a primary, or it could be sometime in the setting or association with other autoimmune diseases like systemic lupus erythematosus. Okay,
lupus. I'm sure.
Yes, lupus. Usually it comes either association or it comes isolated, primary.
And lupus, as we understand, could lead people to eventually be in a wheelchair.
Good. So that's not all patients with lupus, they have antiphospholipid syndrome, about 50% of cases. And the severity, if it is occurring with systemic lupus erythematosus, will be more severe. Primary is, if it is without lupus, is less severe. Not always leading to being in the wheelchair, bedridden, okay? This is some cases they might have lupus affecting the central nervous system, spinal cord, leading to disability. So it is variable, okay, presentation. But yes, such cases treated in tertiary care hospital, but we would like to raise awareness that primary healthcare physician, they suspect such cases, and they refer to us for confirmation, okay?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and doctor, I'm hearing about this disease for the first time, mm-hmm. and I'm wondering how common is this yes. in our society and in the Middle East or GCC in general?
Yes, so we have the prevalence in the general population internationally about 2 to 4%, 2 to 4% mm-hmm. for 100 people, okay? This is Western, okay, world. We don't have our statistics in Saudi Arabia as other diseases, but we think it is more common than the Western communities.
Above average.
Yes, more than I think, because we in our clinic, it is high thrombosis clinic or blood clot clinic, we have seen, let's say, a significant number of antiphospholipid syndrome, so indicating this is a more common than other countries, but we cannot generalize because this is a referral center, so they are, we are receiving cases from different, but that's why we chose this topic. It's a common, it's not rare. We see it in pregnant ladies with frequent miscarriages or other pregnancy complication or blood clot.
And still the main cause is not known for you?
Yeah, etiology is not clearly elucidated. That's why, because it's called syndrome, but we think that this is the it's multifactorial. Nobody knows exactly, can pinpoint to the etiology. It is multifactorial, i.e. maybe hereditary, environmental factors. So nobody exactly know what's the trigger for the autoimmune diseases. But more common, interestingly, more common in females, women than men. Let's say like systemic lupus erythematosus, the ratio 10 to 1. So 10 females will be one male, okay? This one, again, more common in females than males, okay? But exact etiology is not really, you know, known. Okay.
Indeed. Now, tell us as well, Dr. Muhammad, are there levels or stages to the syndrome as well, as in primary, secondary, or perhaps more advanced levels of it?
Yeah, that's why, I mean, the primary means it is the disease without association with either autoimmune disease, SLE. We say this is a primary. The other one that you have association, we call it secondary, associated with or accompanied with other autoimmune disease like systemic lupus erythematosus. It has, you know, implication in the outcome or prognosis. If it occur with SLE or systemic lupus erythematosus, it's worse, you know, prognosis rather than. Many times patient, when they diagnose them with this disease, because the first time to hear about it, we try to explain to them, yani reassure them, okay, this disease is really under control. The mainstay of treatment is anticoagulant therapy. It's different from when occur with systemic lupus erythematosus. The mainstay of treatment is the it's immunosuppressive therapy. Immunosuppressive therapy medication like steroid and other medication. But this one is mainstay is treatment is anticoagulant therapy. We are assured them, okay?
This is the main treatment. Is there any other treatment method for easy cases maybe?
Yes, so it depends on the case, case by case basis. So if we have blood clot, okay, whether it is in the leg veins or break off and go through the heart to the lung, we call it pulmonary embolism. This is okay, treated, or you have a stroke, this is all blood clot, artery vein, we treat it with anticoagulant therapy, which is like heparins, you know, you have the low molecular heparin, the new generation of heparin is injectable under the skin, like enoxaparin or call it Clexane. Some people, we treat them with aspirin only, okay? So aspirin is another form, another medication, we call it like anticoagulant or blood thinner, okay?
Yeah.
That interfere with the platelet, prevent platelet clumping and causing a thrombosis. So it depends which, okay, condition, and it depends the blood clot occurring during pregnancy or not. Because for pregnancy, we have to be careful because there are certain drugs that are safe during pregnancy.
Is aspirin one of them?
Aspirin is safe, yes. The heparin is safe. The low molecular heparin, the injectable heparin under the skin, Clexane or Enohib or Fragmin. But warfarin is considered to be contraindicated, not safe during pregnancy. It can cause, high risk to the fetus. We call it teratogenicity or malformation of the fetus, especially if given the first trimester, the first 8 weeks of pregnancy, because this is the period of organ system formation. We call it organogenesis. This is highly, if receiving this drug during this period, it might cause malformation. But in the subsequent, like second, last trimester can be given.
Indeed. Now tell us a little bit about the treatment for the antiphospholipid syndrome, Dr. Muhammad. What is exactly to be done?
Yes, so always, okay, before treatment we have to secure diagnosis, important diagnosis that we already history, the examination, clinical examination and investigations. Usually we treat the patient. We treat the patient with anticoagulant therapy or blood thinner. This is another name. Mm-hmm. And usually just we tell patient and the blood thinner or anticoagulant is a drug that prevent new clot formation and prevent existing blood clot from enlarging or extension. Okay, like if you have leg vein clot, it might enlarge and break off, go to the lung. So what will happen? The anticoagulant, it will prevent it from extension and breaking off. So this is anticoagulant, is not blood dissolving drug. This is blood and blood thinner. So this is the treatment. Usually we give it through two phases. One is rapidly onset, rapidly acting drug, the heparin, and followed by the Coumadin or warfarin, which is a slow onset of action. Mm-hmm. This is if it is outside pregnancy. If it's during pregnancy, we continue with heparin only.
So it is, for instance, any female who is having antiphospholipid syndrome, she could still go ahead and be pregnant?
Excellent. That's why if we have cases, they don't have blood clot. They have only frequent miscarriages or stillbirth. Stillbirth, the baby will grow up, then in the last stage of pregnancy will die without clear cause. We call it intrauterine fetal death or stillbirth. Or could they have premature labor, like before 34 weeks of pregnancy?
Yeah.
Or they have severe condition, we call it preeclampsia, which is occur in pregnancy, cause high blood pressure, passing protein in the urine. It might decrease the impair the nutrition of the fetus, call it intrauterine growth restriction. So such cases, if they usually they develop the complications, we do for them the workup, the antibodies. We measure the antibodies. Okay, the antibodies. There are three antibodies. We check it: the lobus anticoagulant, anti-beta-glycoprotein, and anticoagulant. It's difficult to know the names, but just the antibodies. If we measure the antibodies and it is positive, high, usually we repeat it in 12 weeks apart to ensure, to make sure this is high. So once we diagnose the patient, what we do, in the next pregnancy, we give them prophylactic medication. We give them the heparin and aspirin during starting of the pregnancy till the end of pregnancy. Usually the outcome is excellent. Excellent outcome to have successful pregnancy. I will tell you, we have one patient who have nine times recurrent miscarriages, consecutive, nine times. Then she was diagnosed early. That's why we want to spread awareness to diagnose such patient early rather than to wait for 10 years. We diagnosed the patient from the first time she was given the heparin and aspirin, successful pregnancy, four successful pregnancies. Mm-hmm. So this is very, effective therapy. We have another patient who have three times death of the fetus. She is wondering what's wrong, okay, with me. I have a fetus, does everything fine, just the last stage will die inside the uterus. We call it stillbirth. Again, treated, and she has successful pregnancy outcome. So this is very important reason for pregnancy complications.
To make people fully aware of this problem. Because I just remember that I read the story on the WhatsApp a few days ago, where an old lady, she had a blood clot here or something, and they massaged her with hot water, and then the blood clot transferred to her lungs and she died. Mm-hmm. That was in a quick stage. So they said, be careful, don't deal with such things, and always seek a physician. Do not come up with ideas from your mind. And this is why we're trying to make people aware. But doctor, before we conclude, let me ask you, after the treatment, is there a higher chance to have it again?
Oh, okay, that's why the treatment for them is long life or lifelong.
So
it's not short. Usually treat deep vein thrombosis if it is due to transient risk factor like surgery, hospitalization, or fracture for 3 months. Such patient, the treatment is indefinite or lifelong because of the high risk of recurrence. It might recur after you stop treatment. That's why this patient should be on lifelong anticoagulant therapy, and usually very effective. It will prevent the recurrence. This is patient who have a deep vein thrombosis or stroke or any blood clot in other veins. But patient who have no blood clot, only pregnancy complications, usually they receive the heparin and aspirin during pregnancy and the postpartum period, 6 week post delivery, then they stop and they take only aspirin. Aspirin lifelong, okay?
Lifelong.
That's why we have to differentiate, because this is a disease has two main components, the pregnancy complication and recurrent blood clots in arteries and veins, okay? Mm.
This is why the treatment is different from male to female.
And, sure.
Talking about the treatment methods. Mm. And with this, we would like to thank you, Dr. Mohammed Ashif, for being with us on the show and for and talking to us about this disease.
That complicated syndrome.
This is something that I heard about for the first time, and I guess many people as well.
Absolutely, Ghazi. And Dr. Mohammed, once again, thank you very, very much for being with us. It is a really, really a complicated subject that you simplified very much for us all. And following this discussion with you, we are going to be talking about infertility as well. So as you were talking about some of the women who do
things are related.
And yes, indeed. So with this, once again, thank you very much. We wish you a wonderful weekend, and we hope to see you back again in the Saudi Morning Show.
Thank you very much. Okay.
We were in discussion with Dr. Mohammed Ashif, who is a consultant thrombosis expert and as well as a doctor of internal medicine. If you have any questions from Dr. Mohammed Ashif about the antiphospholipid syndrome that we were talking about, or any other questions as well related to his specialty, feel free to send those to us on Facebook, on Twitter, as well as through our email. For the moment, stay tuned. It's time for a short interlude in the program.
To see an MRI of your head and see a black spot in your brain, yeah, that'll sort of reinforce, yes, I had a stroke.
7 years ago, a clot had formed in an artery in Rebecca Sherman's brain. Rebecca was so incapacitated that she was unable to walk or talk. Dr. Maria DeSancho pulled her through.
Hi, Ms. Sherman.
How are you?
How are you doing?
Hello.
How are you, Mr. Sherman?
Good.
So
how is everything going on with you?
Everything's going fine.
The main risk factors, let's say, for a stroke include hypertension, smoking, diabetes, okay? So she didn't have any of those risk factors. If you find that in a young person, you really have to look to try to find why this happened.
Rebecca's blood showed Dr. DeSancho that Rebecca has an autoimmune condition called antiphospholipid antibody syndrome, or APS, a condition that can cause blood to clot more easily.
A lot, right?
And Rebecca had been taking estrogen-containing birth control pills, which can also make blood clot more easily.
Oh yeah, and then there was that. And then I was.
The more kind of risk factors that you have, the more chances to have a blood clot.
33% of all strokes in people under 50 are due to APS.
Some people have these antibodies and never had any problem in terms of clotting. We don't know right now who, and that's one of the interests that I have, who having these antibodies is going to end up having a blood clot down the road. We do not know.
Hematologists do know that pregnancy increases the risks of clotting.
2 weeks. I'm having a baby in 2 weeks. Talk about terrifying fear. Yes, I'm having a baby in 2 weeks, and I'm generally freaked out.
Well, you shouldn't be.
Like birth control pills, pregnancy also revs up the clotting system. a condition Rebecca controls with daily injections of blood thinners, medication that slows the process of blood clotting.
Okay. Which one for him?
That'll be the daddy chair right
there. APS can also risk the health of the baby.
This gets harder and harder each time to get up on the table.
It's the cause of up to 1 in 4 early miscarriages.
There's the baby's head, and the head is pressed up against the placenta.
What a sweaty
little squish.
Wow. OBGYN Dr. Robin Kalish has monitored the health of the baby throughout the pregnancy by monthly ultrasound.
Okay. So here you can see the heart. You can see all the four chambers of the heart.
Blood pressure been good.
As the delivery date grows closer, the balance of concern shifts from the baby back to Rebecca. Because her blood thinners put her at risk of hemorrhaging during delivery, Rebecca will be taken off the very medication that has kept her from having another stroke. Rebecca's trepidation isn't just about being a first-time mom. In danger of a stroke, Rebecca has been on blood thinners throughout her pregnancy.
Hi. How are you doing?
But 24 hours ago, they were stopped to reduce her risk of bleeding during delivery. Now she is again at higher risk for developing a clot.
How's it going, Daddy-o?
Pretty good. The issues of whether she could have a stroke during delivery or not, you can understand why it may not be that high a risk, but it doesn't mean the nervousness goes away, because there always is a risk, of course. But I'm still nervous about it.
Rebecca's physicians have taken every precaution and have contingency plans should anything go wrong.
How is everything going on?
It's going fine.
Deanna Sherman is born without complications.
You are?
Good, right?
It's amazing.
It's like so peaceful. It's like, I tell you, it's like a miracle, really.
Back to you, our dear viewers, still with us on this Saudi Morning Show, and now it is time to have our second discussion of the day. It's about infertility, the causes and the solutions. Join us in the studio. Here's Dr. Abtissam Al-Mizyan, the consultant.